topic today is understanding the significance of Christ's resurrection. Because indeed Christians all over the world are celebrating the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'd like to say that as we celebrate the risen and living Lord Jesus Christ, whatever is dead in your life is coming alive now in the name of Jesus. He lives, so you will live also. And because He lives, you have what it takes to face tomorrow. You have what it takes to face your future in the name of Jesus Christ. I'd like you to know that the power of His resurrection, which raised Him, God's highest power, God's greatest power, that was put into play, that was exerted to raise Jesus Christ out of the grave on the third day, did not only bring Him back to life. The Bible says in Ephesians 1, from verses 9 and 20, say that power also set Him at the right hand of God, at the right hand of the Father in heavenly places. He didn't only set Him there. He said He set Him above all principalities and powers. I'd like you to know that by that same resurrection power, whatever is dead around you is not only coming back to life, but that same power will raise you to a position of authority and favor, which the right hand of the Father represents. And that same power will set you above your contemporaries, will set you up above your mates in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is an indisputable truth. It cannot be disputed. Now, this truth was copiously prophesied in the Old Testament, and it was dramatized in types and shadows in the Old Testament. For instance, David spoke in Psalm 16, verse 10. He said, "For thou will not leave thy soul, my soul in hell." It was Jesus Christ was speaking through him. "That the Father will not leave his soul in hell, neither will he allow or suffer his Holy One to see corruption." That is, his body will not get rotten in the grave, because he will resurrect, he will rise on the third day. Now, we also read Jesus used his own mouth to say something in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 40. That just as Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man himself, he will be in the belly of the earth for 3 days and three nights. Amen. Now, that was speaking concerning his death, burial, and resurrection. So he arose triumphant. Now, there were also witnesses. The apostles were witnesses. Other very faithful disciples like Mary Magdalene was also a witness. James, the brother of Jesus Christ, was not among the 12, but he was also a witness. And the Bible says, about 500 others saw him after he resurrected, before he ascended to be at the right hand of the Father. Hallelujah. Now, Christ's resurrection, we are looking at the significance. And let's begin to pay attention to the significance of Christ's resurrection. The resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is the crowning event. Let's look at the scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15. We'll read from verse 3. We'll first of all read from verse 3. We'll read up to 7, and then we'll go to 13. That's our main text for this study. 1 Corinthians 15, from verse 3. It says, "For I deliver," Paul speaking here, Paul writing here, "For I deliver unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures, verse 5, and that he was seen of Cephas, and then of the 12. After that, he was seen at once, of whom the greater part remain until this present. But some are falling asleep. Verse 7. He said, after that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. Hallelujah. He was seen. There are people to witness his resurrection, living witnesses. Hallelujah. Now, if we move further, verse 13. Let's go to verse 13, 14, and 17 for time. He said, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? Here, some people were contending that it is impossible for the dead to rise. Look at verse 14. And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain, because the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ is the basis of our preaching. It is the crowning event of Christ's redemptive work on behalf of the saints, believers in Christ Jesus. We have the gospel, which is the power of God unto salvation, like Paul said. We have the gospel today that carries the power to save, to heal, to deliver, based on the truth that Christ resurrected. It was his resurrection. In fact, the message, the gospel we preach, is based on his death, burial, and resurrection. No other founder of any religion, even though Christianity is not a religion, or any philosophical association that exists today that has this testimony of resurrection. All of them died. You can still find their corpse or their bones in their graves. But our Lord Jesus Christ arose as he prophesied, as he said, and it was written concerning him. Praise the Lord. So, resurrection is the greatest celebration in the Christian faith. Now, if he did not rise, if Christ did not rise, then, like Paul said, then we are not saved. And if Christ be not risen, our faith is vain, verse 17. And we are still in our sin. That is, we cannot claim that our sins have been forgiven. It is the resurrection of Christ that made it possible. How did that become a possibility through his resurrection? Now the Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission or forgiveness of sin. Now, I'd like you to know that on the cross, Jesus died. The price for our sins was paid, but the remission of our sin or the forgiveness of our sin took place when he took his blood to the heavenly Holy of Holies after his resurrection. Now, if Christ did not resurrect, it means that he did not take his blood to the heavenly Holy of Holies, where he presented his blood in the supreme court of the universe, where it was accepted, and our redemption was sealed, and our complete liberty from Satan's dominion was obtained. Praise the Lord. So, resurrection made the forgiveness of our sins possible. And if anybody is saying that Christ did not resurrect, then our sins have not been forgiven, means we have not been justified, we are still in our sin, or God forbid, our sins have been forgiven. Now, another significance we need to look at is the death of Jesus Christ was the emergence of the church. It marked the emergence, the new creation, the born-again believer. Paul said, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Now the new creation, the believer in Christ, the born again believer, resurrected in Christ. It was the resurrection of Jesus Christ that gave birth to the manifestation of the new creation or the believer in Christ. And so that is another important thing we need to know. And the new creation, that which is the church of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ, emerged from the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so he died on the cross. The victory obtained through his death on the cross. He was buried. And the Bible says he went to hell because he carried the sin, the old sin of the world on himself. He went to hell, to the very territory of Satan. And there he disarmed him and spoiled him. Colossians 2 and verse 15, I read. Let me start from verse 14. He said, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that were against us, which were contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them, openly triumphing over them. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So our Lord Jesus Christ went to the grave, went to hell, and disarmed the devil. And then you remember, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, it says, for as much as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. So Satan was destroyed when Jesus died on the cross. Satan and his powers and all that he had were destroyed when Jesus died. The death on the cross destroyed Satan. And then when he went to the grave, he went to hell, he disarmed. The disarmament of Satan, the gates of hell, took place during his death. And when he resurrected triumphantly. That is to tell you as a believer in Christ that you are a product of his resurrection. You are a product of his victory. His victory on the cross, his victory during his burial, his victory at his resurrection. And we share with him because the Bible says in Romans chapter 6 from precisely verses 3 and 4, the Bible says that we have been baptized through baptism. We have been incorporated into the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Having identified with his death, it says we have also identified with his resurrection into newness of life. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, so we have what it takes. We have been ushered to his resurrection to live a new life and to behave in a new dimension. No longer in the old way we used to behave. Praise the Lord. I'd like you to also know that Christ's death, burial, resurrection is a living evidence of the believer's triumph over the devil and his complete disarmament. Satan was completely disarmed and he was destroyed when Christ died. Praise the Lord. As believers in Christ, we share in all of his victory. His victory is our victory because we have an inseparable union with Jesus Christ, which was made possible by our baptism or incorporation into Jesus Christ. The work accomplished by the Holy Spirit when we give our lives to Jesus Christ. I'd like you to celebrate your victory. It is because of this victory that the Bible says that God always causes us to triumph and make manifest by us the Sabbath of his knowledge in every place. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Thanks be unto God who always causes us to triumph. Like you to know, no matter whatever battles you are facing now, the triumph of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we are celebrating during this Easter, will deliver your victory to you. Because God is always with you, by you, and for you, to ensure that you succeed and overcome in every battle you are confronted with right now. Heaven, I'd like to encourage you to be a partaker of what we have just heard about, and all of the great privileges and wonderful things released as a result of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, which we are celebrating. You have to come into Christ. You have to become a believer in Christ. Then the Bible says, all things about you becomes new. We are going to be dealing with that series from Wednesday. But listen, how do you come into Christ? By believing. He says, to as many as receive him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, the children of God, even to them that believe in his name. And he said, even the devil believes and trembles. So believing is not enough. You have to confess that he is the Lord. Wherever you are, say with me, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I believe that Jesus died for my sin. He was buried, and he arose on the third day to justify me. I accept him as Lord. I am now born again. I am now a child of God. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. God bless you.